home stepping edition of the Boneyard. Grab your Bible, open up an application on your phone, open up a web browser, however you follow along in Holy Scripture, because we here at the Boneyard believe in sola scriptura. Now you may be saying, Kevin, are you speaking in tongues or is that Latin? Or are you speaking gibberish? No. It's Latin and it means the Scriptures and the Scriptures alone. We don't believe the Watchtower, the Book of Mormon, someone's personal revelation and dream, or even culture trumps Holy Scripture, that the Christian is under authority of God's Holy Word, because we read what Paul says in Timothy, it's good for training, for reproof, and training in righteousness. So open your Bible, open up to Galatians chapter 1. If you've been following along with us in our series of Galatians, you know we're knee-deep in good, rich theology. So you open up in Galatians chapter 1. We can read the letters that Paul wrote to Galatia. He was probably in Ephesus, or he was probably in Corinth when he wrote this. He planted this church just 3 years ago, and now they're already being shook by false teachers and false preachers, the zealous Judaizers who are creeping up within the congregation, turning the hearts of the flock against Paul, Christ's apostle. And now we see Paul writing to these churches, defending himself, and we can apply these words today. Because still today in our culture, there's still bishops rising up. There's still people of authority and Sunday school teachers, pastors, youth pastors who are saying that when Paul was writing something, it was just his opinion. It's just what Paul thinks. It's just what his idea. So we open up to Galatians. But then, and we read what Paul says and how he defends himself 2,000 years later in our churches now. So not only does it echo from Galatia, it echoes to your county, your town, your city. So open up to Galatians chapter 1. We're going to pick up in verse number 10 as Paul is preaching. If you remember our last episode, we talked about Paul. He's saying he's astonished. He's shocked. He's awestruck that they have abandoned the gospel for a different gospel. Not that there is another gospel. That these Judaizers have taught the churches and the congregations, their Sunday schools, and there's their small groups, that they can earn their favor with God by doing religious rites and acts and earning favor with God and earning merit, that God would owe them heaven. And Paul tells them that they've abandoned the gospel. Let us not be shocked when we see people who are fragile in the faith. Not that the scriptures are fragile, but our hearts are feeble and fragile. Whenever we don't read our Bibles and we put things spiritual on the back burner to streaming Netflix or Hulu or Amazon Prime, or just to see what's on television or cable. When we neglect the things of God, our spiritual man grows weak. Paul was telling us through Scripture that we shouldn't be that way. What we can read in Romans chapter 12, that we're to renew our mind daily. If we look at the epistle of Romans and Galatians, they go neck and neck. We can see the systematic theology of Romans as Paul is writing to Rome. He's writing to the church in Rome that he's never met face to face. And he's telling them his system of thought. But here in Galatia, he has a relationship with them. He's offended and wounded, and he's defending his apostleship to those. And he's also giving them systematic theology and understanding and telling them where and from what authority he speaks from. So we look in verse 10, for I am now seeking the approval of man or God. Or am I trying to please man? If I was still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ. We see he's using the word servant again. And we read the beginning of the chapter, Paul, not from men nor through men, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him up from the dead. Paul is saying that if I'm trying to please man, believe me, I wouldn't be apostle of the gospel. If I'm trying to please man, I wouldn't be so zealous about the gospel, because men are offended by the gospel. You're saying, Kevin, what are you talking about? Men being offended by the gospel? Men are always trying to earn their way to heaven. This is where we get the phrase religion, where we earn our way to heaven, where we make God owe us a place in heaven, where we believe that we can tithe enough and make God give us a place in heaven, where we're polite enough, or we even think we could recycle enough to get into heaven. Paul here says, am I trying to seek the approval of man or of God? Let me encourage the gospel preacher who just so happens to be watching the Boneyard. Let me encourage you. Are you trying to please men? And are you trying to win their applause? Are you trying to gain popularity? Let me remind you that according to our standards of modern checklist of successful ministries, that Paul was a complete failure. He didn't own a jet. He didn't have any Gucci nice suits in. He didn't have Egyptian cotton blankets for his bed or sheets. He wasn't world renowned, and he wasn't looked upon favorably. When most cities he entered in, they wanted to kill him and beat him. They wanted his head on a platter. He wasn't applauded and jeered. He wasn't on CNN, and he wasn't on Oprah. He wasn't on the cover of Time magazine. He wasn't applauded. Now, there's nothing wrong with fame, but we must remember, as gospel preachers, He didn't call us to be famous. He called us to be faithful. We see here Paul, he's not seeking the approval of man. He's trying to seek the approval of God. He'd rather have the jeers of heaven than the applause from here on the earth. He'd rather speak the truth even if his voice cracked or if it quaked or if it would tremble. He spoke the truth because God called him. See, we see here Paul, he says, am I trying to please man or I would not be a servant of Christ? See, we must remember that Paul was young. He was zealous for the religion. He was actually the persecutor of the church. He was prominent. He had an entourage. But Paul was riding around on his high horse, and he was going around persecuting the Christians. Now, if Paul was to please the people, he would stay in that position because he was zealous for religion. See, there are those who are watching who are not Christians, and they would want you to know, Christian, if you're watching, as you look with them, with judgment. They might have a black teardrop on their eyes. They might be tattooed up their arms. They might have track marks. They might be selling rocks on the corner. They might have a three-piece suit on. They might be selling their body for money. They might be listening and watching with a hangover. They might be struggling with depression. They might be raking pornography into their eyes and into their heart. And they're dealing with issues, and they would want the Christian to know, quit trying to sell me religion. Quit trying to tell me to do better and to be nicer and be polite and just to do these things to get to heaven because I can't. That's what the sinner, the one who's ruined, who's wrecked, who's chained by addiction, who's a slave to sin, would say to the Christian. They would look at the Christian and say, stop telling me your bylaws. Stop telling me to not watch rated R movies. Stop telling me to give up drinking. Stop telling me to put down the needle. Stop telling me to all those things. Tell me the gospel. Christian, did you hear that? Tell them the gospel. If we're trying to gather men for sake of gathering a group of men, well, we can gather a crowd. But let us preach the gospel. Not to win the applause of the world. Because Paul, he gave all that up. He said, if I'm trying to win the approval of men, I certainly wouldn't be doing what I'm doing. I lost the entourage. I lost the fame. I lost the official papers from the church of the Judaizers trying to cut people off at the knees, to drag them into the street and have them executed. I lost all that to become from the persecutor to the preacher. If we can see anything here, we can see the memoirs of Paul as we begin in verse 11, how God can take the persecutor and make him a preacher. Maybe you're watching, you're saying, I know people who persecute Christianity, who persecute God, and they even put God on trial, and they're so far gone, Kevin. There's no reaching them. They're so far gone, they're ruined. They're strung out on whatever, their favorite sin, and they're just so far gone. I don't even think that Jesus could reach them. Why do we believe that? Why would we even think that? I just want to let you know, Boneyard, there's no stretch marks on grace. That God, his arms are not like a T-Rex dinosaur that he can't reach. And that his arm is not, it's not feeble where he can't lift. And he won't, he's not in heaven saying, I'm not stooping that low to save that guy. I'm not stooping that low to save her. She had an abortion. I'm not stooping that low. She sells her body. I'm not stooping that low. He has an addiction to pornography. I'm not stooping that low. He's too dirty. I'm not stooping that low. She's been molested. She's damaged. I'm not stooping that low. God's not in heaven saying those things. If you're watching and you gave up on somebody, You're saying, Gavin, they once were a Christian or they've never been a Christian. Start praying. His arms not too short that he can't reach. His words are powerful enough to break the stony ground of their hearts. He can speak to the dead and they'll live again. That's what Paul is telling us here as he's going to defend himself to this church. Because the Judaizers, these religious people who are rising up in the church, are trying to tell the congregation that Paul, he's not even an official apostle. That he went to Jerusalem and he sat at the feet of Peter. And Peter had to train him and teach him on what to say. Now Paul defends himself to these Judaizers and these false teachers. As we look in verse 11, "For I would have you know, brothers, that the gospel that was preached by me is not a man's gospel." A man's gospel. Kevin, what is that? That's where I would tell you, try harder. Give more. Read your Bible more. Give out turkeys on Thanksgiving. Go to the Salvation Army and donate everything you got just so you can get to heaven. If I were to tell you to get in an airplane and fly into a building and kill everyone around you, plus yourself, just so you can enter paradise, that would be a man's gospel. If I were to tell you to get on a bicycle and ride around your neighborhood, pedal as hard as you can, put on a white shirt and a black tie and go door to door and tell people good news and tell them, give them watchtowers or whatever LDS stuff, and that's how you enter into heaven, enter into paradise by earning your way to heaven with good works, that's a man gospel. Paul is saying here, he's not preaching a man's gospel. It's not something that he was taught. It was something that was revealed to him by Jesus himself. Look in verse 12, "For I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through the revelation of Jesus Christ." This echoes out all to those who were wanting to say that Paul was a bigamist. Or Paul was a racist, or Paul had it all wrong, or Paul didn't, he shouldn't have said those things in Corinthians or Romans. He shouldn't have said it that way. He has a political problem. He was narrow-minded. When Paul spoke, he spoke with authority. When Paul spoke, he was direct mouthpiece of God. He wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. He was God's representative. Was he God? No. We must understand that God used his personality, and we see his personality written on the pages, but God spoke through him. He was inspired by the Holy Spirit. So we see that what he spoke, it was God's authority. So we see here Paul, "I did not receive it from any man." This goes out to the Judaizers of this church and this community who are saying that Paul is not even telling you the same thing that he's telling other churches. Don't you understand? Paul is, he's a fake, he's a fraud. And these fake false teachers and preachers are turning the hearts of the congregation against Paul. And now Paul, like a gentle, loving father, a spiritual father to this flock, is riding with a heavy hand across this letter, swaying the hearts of his flock back to him, back to following him, pointing to Christ, while these false wolves, these Judaizers, the ones who are telling the people to earn their way to heaven, to circumcise themselves, to follow the Old Testament and follow after Moses and do all 613 different laws to earn their way into heaven, Paul is being brokenhearted. Paul is being moved. He's being swayed. He's probably writing this with tears. So, Pastor, as you're watching the Boneyard, you can relate. But no, it's not an isolated incident when your flock attacks you or hurts you or wounds you. Even Paul, by our own standards, who never owned a jet and who's not selling out stadiums and who has his own flock hating him at this point, even Paul went through trials and tribulations. But Paul remained faithful. What about you, minister? Will you stay faithful? Will you stay faithful to your Sunday school, your youth group? Will you stay faithful to your church and your parsonage? Will you stay faithful to your congregation? Will you, daddy, stay faithful to your children? Will you, mommy, stay faithful to your husband and your children? Will you, single mom, stay faithful? Will you, kids, stay faithful, even through trials and tribulation? No. We're not saying Christianity is all snow cones and burritos. It's not Skittles and rainbows and unicorns. We're just telling you the truth here on the Boneyard, that sometimes life is hard and it kicks you in the face, but power of grace lifts us back up. His mercy strengthens us, and our weaknesses, he makes us strong. So let us boast in all the more weaknesses. Let us come to Christ and say, Lord, I'm weak. Lord, I'm wounded. Oh, this cross is heavy. Don't take the cross, Lord. Don't take this cross from my shoulders. Just give me a stronger back. Lord, be with me. Carry me when I can't walk. Be with me. Be a light into my path. Strengthen me. Guide me. Be the voice behind me, telling me which way to go. This is what Paul's saying. He's trying to win back the affection of his people. Any good pastor, any good preacher knows the people he's preaching to. He knows their afflictions, and he's patient with them like the good shepherd. As an under-shepherd, he comes alongside them, not driving them like a sheepdog. If you remember in our past episode, I told you about a sheepdog who comes behind the flock, nipping at their heels, biting and even scaring them, driving them. But the good shepherd, he leads in front. He comes along, and he's gentle, and he carries us. But we see here Paul being a gentle under-shepherd, coming beside his flock, encouraging, trying to drive out the wolves and winning the hearts of the people in the congregation. For 13, for you have heard of my former life in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it. We see here some of Paul's rap sheet. If we look back in Acts chapter 9, there was a deacon was young. His name was Stephen, and they called him to take care of the sick and to wait on tables and help the widows. And Paul, being young and zealous for religion, he approved and maybe even riled up the crowd to kill Stephen. As the ones who executed Stephen threw their coats at the feet of Paul, and Paul approved. Paul said, yeah, go ahead. And this Saul was given orders from the high priest. He was given orders, those who were religious, to go find these Christians and take them out, to get rid of them. See, Saul was zealous, and he thought what he was doing was right, and he thought it was God's will. Many times people full of zeal, full of passion, can be genuine, but they can be genuinely wrong. Paul, who was genuine in his beliefs, he was full of dead men's bones, full of religion, until God reached, knocked him off his high horse on the road to Damascus. You're saying, Kevin, what are you talking about? If you go read Acts 9, this Paul that wrote Galatians and many of the other epistles, this high horse, arrogant young man, zealous and powerful, who was given authority by men to persecute the church, was knocked down to the ground, and his eyes were blinded, but his spiritual eyes were open as Jesus himself spoke to Paul. He said, Paul, why are you persecuting me? It's not good for you to kick against the stall. You're hurting yourself, Paul. Then Paul, who was blinded, feebled around, and he went home. He went to a place, and he stayed there 3 days, and he didn't eat, and he probably thought about and chewed over what had happened. He can't see anything. Then a young man who was called by God, Ananias, goes and he speaks to Paul. And he talks to Paul and he lays hands on Paul. He doesn't train Paul on what to say. He tells him that Jesus is the Messiah, and Paul listens, and Paul finally believes, and he lays hands on Paul, and Paul receives back his sight, and then Paul does something outstanding. The persecutor becomes the preacher. Paul begins preaching the gospel. Yes, Paul was zealous for the law, but the law only kills. The law only puts us under bondage. The law shows us how much of a sinner we are, how we're liars standing before God, how we're blasphemers, how we pay Hollywood to laugh at movies, and we laugh at when they blaspheme our God, how we're liars and thieves, how we're adulterers at heart, and how we lust with our eyes. Well, the law slays us and shows us just how dirty we are. The law shows us that we make idols out of good things like family. We make idols out of money and career. We make idols out of UTVs and four-wheelers and boats. We make idols out of vacation and comfort and even entertainment. We make idols even out of ministry. These things we worship, the things we could not live without if we didn't have those things. The law shows us that we're stained to the very being of our soul and how dirty we are. The law shows us, and the law says, try harder. Stop sinning. Do better. Button up your shirt and put your shirt tail in. And don't wear blue jeans. Comb your hair this certain way. Don't wear fibers that are two different kinds. Don't eat trail mix. Do this, do this. Eat kosher. Be nice. Be polite. Keep the Sabbath. Do all these things. Read these many scriptures every day. Do this, do this, do this. Run harder. Try harder. Do more, Kevin. Go, 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 go. Law just beats us like a pimp. But we see here Paul. Paul, the persecutor. Paul, who knew the law, became the preacher. He goes into these cities and he preaches the gospel. He tells people who are addicted to things, people who are dirty, people who have done bad things in their past, people who are stained to their souls, people who know they're murderers, people who know they've done abortions, people who know they're sleeping around outside of marriage, people who know they're shacking up, people who know they're dirty and they're tattooed all the way up their arms with wicked, evil things. And the tattoos on their arms only hide the stains and dirty things in their souls. People who know they're going to hell. Paul goes preach to them, and he doesn't give them the law. He gives them the gospel. He says, I was so far gone. I was so religious. I was so dirty. I was trying to earn my way to heaven. But Jesus died for someone like me. Maybe you're watching and you're like Paul. Or maybe you know someone like Saul who was so far gone that God could never touch them, that God could never reach them, that they're so addicted, that they're so ruined that Jesus wouldn't even bother with them. And maybe you're watching and you believe you're that way, that you're so stained and so ruined that your righteousness is as a filthy mud puddle. You believe that God is in heaven saying, man, I really messed up when I made them. They're liberal. They're Democrat. They're Republican. They're nasty. They're dirty. They're religious. They believe they're good enough without me. I really messed up when I made them. Jesus, who was the perfect person, the greatest man to walk across the horizon of humanity, stepped out of heaven. God's only Son, the second incarnate of the Trinity. He walked this earth never sinning a single time, never lying, never lusting, never envying, never coveting, never being angry, never murdering someone with his heart or with his mouth, destroying the reputation, never having idols, never dishonoring the Sabbath day, never taking God's name in vain, pure and holy, good and righteous. He came for dirty, rotten, stinky people. Those who were sick in the soul. Those who were ruined. Jesus came for people like me. Everything bad about me. My rap sheet. All the things that I've done in the past. My religiousness. My self-righteousness. My pride. My judgmental attitude. Everything about me was put on Jesus. And everything pure. Everything holy. Everything good and righteous, everything righteous and wholesome, everything that was pleasing to God was put on me. It's like we switch places, like he's a substitute. He's the atonement. It's like we read in 2 Corinthians 5:21. God took him who knew no sin that we might be the righteousness of God. And God took all the bad things that was meant for me and you, because we know that the wages, the price, the cost of sin is death. And God took all those bad things, those abortions, those lies, those angers, and all those things, the unforgiveness that we need to give people, took all those things and placed them on Jesus and took all the blessings, all the righteousness, all the cleanliness, all the sanctification and goodness, and placed it on us. And Jesus died in my place. So we see here Paul was preaching the gospel, preaching to the Gentiles, preaching to those who did not deserve heaven. In spite of us, Jesus died for us. The good guy of the Bible. The good guy of the Bible is Jesus. And he died for all the bad people. And that's us. This is the gospel. This is the gospel that Paul wrote about. This is the gospel that Paul preached to the Galatians. This is the gospel that we still hear echoing 2,000 years ago to right now. You're saying, Kevin, I'm too far gone. I'm too dirty. Why would God want anybody like me? Rest assured and know this, that I'm not leaning against the cross, leaning against the cross, going pointing at it and saying, you need to get some of this cross. This is awesome stuff. This is the way to go. You need to have a purpose. No, I'm not. I'm at the foot of the cross, weeping with everyone else. I'm crying and I'm worshiping Jesus because He saved someone like me. I was on the highway of hell and I deserved hell. But in His grace and His forbearance and His mercy, He saved stinky, rotten people, train wrecks like me. He saves religious people and rebellious people. He saves those who shake their fists at God and blame Him for all the bad things. He saves those who ignore Him His entire life and they hate Him. He saves those who are like these zealous Judaizers, religious people saying, try harder, give more, do more. He saves religious people who believe they can get to heaven on the merit. Jesus saves sinners. Jesus saves dirty people. We see here in verse 15, for He has set me apart from when I was born. He had set me apart, and who had called me by His grace. It's by grace that anyone goes to heaven. You're saying, Kevin, I'm not good enough. You don't understand. If I would go to church, the church would fall down. If you were walking to any church and you look around, there's no perfect people there. They're all stained and they're all ruined. But Jesus, the gentle shepherd, died in their place. He laid down His life freely for dirty, rotten people. If heaven were to be empty and hell were to be full, it would be fair. So repent. Repent of your sins. Throw down your sins and trust in Jesus. He is the only way to get to heaven.